Hello, Carla Hartley here. Today I'm going to be talking to you again about how not to cost yourself money in a family law proceeding. Last week I discussed mediation, and I'm going to be continuing in the same vein today with a discussion of the collaborative process of resolving family law disputes. So the collaborative process was very popular in the jurisdictions in which I practiced for about 10 years, and I think it has, for the most part, fallen out of favor in those areas. I myself never signed up for the collaborative group, and I did, however, get a lot of cases that had fallen out of the collaborative proceeding. Now, here's what happens. The reason I was getting those cases in the collaborative groups, when you are agreeing to pursue your family law case in a collaborative fashion, you have to sign an agreement that says, if everything falls apart, I have to start over. I can't use any of the documents obtained in the collaborative process in an adversarial proceeding. I can't use any of the information obtained in the collaborative process in the adversarial proceeding. So you're going to have this situation where I think we've agreed on most things. We just need some help. And then you find out you haven't agreed on most things, or something was concealed, or there's a level of trust or acrimony that had not been adequately explained to counsel before putting yourself into the collaborative process. The collaborative process has a mindset. It requires that the parties be able to consider the other party's point of view and not simply their own. Now, some jurisdictions, I think Los Angeles County has tried this extensively, for their collaborative proceedings, what they will do is refer the parties to a mental health professional to assess whether they are good candidates for the collaborative proceeding. That may or may not work. Some people know exactly how to talk to a mental health professional, and for the very brief involvement of that professional, it may not be sufficient to get past the roadblocks. Now, sometimes the mental health professional will stay involved for the whole thing, and boy, you want to talk about expensive. Now you've got two parties, two attorneys, and sometimes one to two mental health professionals that are involved in making sure everything goes according to plan, according to someone's plan, and does not fall out of the collaborative process. Now you've gotten away from the practice of law, I think, and being an advocate for your client, and try to become sort of a negotiator. Now, being an advocate does require negotiation, and I'm going to discuss that next. One thing that we find that has worked very well, and there's no official tag to put on it, but I'm going to call it cooperative engagement with opposing counsel. Not collaborative, which has a whole different set of rules, has its own set of rules, but just cooperating with opposing counsel. Saying basically, I've got this client, you've got that client, these are the facts, this is the law, let's see if we can't work out an agreement. That's good for what my client is interested in, that's good for what your client is interested in. This has the advantage when you are dealing with knowledgeable family law professionals as your attorneys of making sure that you are made aware of your rights and your responsibilities under the law, that sufficient discovery is conducted, that we can be fairly sure that we have all the assets before us, and if we don't have all the assets before us, then we're going to have language in there that preserves our right to distribute that later when it is discovered. The family law professional who is dealing in a collaborative process is usually going to be a pretty good attorney, not a collaborative, a cooperative process, is usually going to be a pretty good attorney who's got substantial experience in your local family law courts, who's been involved in your local family law bar association for years, and what you're trading on is the relationships. For instance, there are a number of attorneys, when I come into the case or when I know these attorneys are in the case, we're like, yeah, we're probably going to settle this case, not because we're going to roll over, but because I'm going to know what the facts are, they're going to know what the facts are, we're going to know what the law is, and we're going to be able to predict how the case is going to go. We're going to be able to explain to our client, okay, this is your blue sky scenario, this is your black sky scenario, and this is how much it's going to cost you in fees and costs to get from A to B, and there's no guarantee which one you're going to end up with. A lot of times that discussion goes a long way towards resolving the case, and it's not going to be where either party is ecstatically happy. Both parties are going to have some give and take. I want to emphasize here that you're not going to be happy because you're getting a divorce. Very few people go into the dissolution proceeding just as happy as they could possibly be, knowing that the community estate is going to be divided. Very few people go into a divorce proceeding going, oh, yay, I'm going to have to figure out how to support myself, how to contribute to my own support. I'm going to have to pay support. You know, all of these considerations. I'm going to have to share my kids. All of this is distressing to people. So having a competent family law professional who can guide you through it and who can recognize that we're dealing with you in an emotional capacity, not just in the legal capacity, is important. Sometimes a party's objections to a settlement are completely based in what they want and not what the law says. So it's our job to walk them through that. Now, because of this, and because sometimes there are genuine issues of fact and law that are going to require the court's input, that's why I also like working cooperatively when possible with opposing counsel. Because when we hit the point where we have something that we can't agree on, that we can't resolve, we might be able to resolve a bunch of threshold issues, we might be able to resolve one or two side issues or even really substantive central issues, and run into a snag on something that's really important to both parties that we're just going to have to set a mandatory settlement conference for, get the judge's input, maybe have a trial on those narrow issues. The narrow trial is where you save a lot of money because you're not trying all issues over a series of multi-days. We have competently settled and resolved most issues. We've made sure you know your rights and responsibilities while we're going through this. We make sure that any agreement you have entered into is knowing, voluntary, and intelligent. And we've made sure that you know what it's going to cost you to pursue an adversarial position on the things that are still in dispute. I think all of that is something that you don't get from a collaborative proceeding. The nicest thing about working this way compared to a collaborative proceeding is if we go through this and we've gone back and forth a little bit and we figured out this case is just not going to settle. There's no way this case can settle, then we're not going to have to start over again because we're not bound to any agreement that requires us to start over again and rediscover all the stuff we've already figured out. So I think this is a good synopsis of how things work when you have experienced counsel, experienced local counsel with local relationships, and when you have those people who are very knowledgeable on the law and able to figure out what the facts are in their case and are able to convey to their clients the reality of the situation in which they find themselves. Now, our standard at Hartley Lamas is if we're going to settle a case, it's going to be on terms equal to or better than we would get if we went to court, unless the client has had that explained to him or her and wants to settle anyway. We make sure that you know what you would get, what you would be likely to get, and what you might really not want to get. You've got to know the full range of possibilities before you go to trial. And I think you also need to have some kind of assessment of the likely success and the cost of winning. I like to tell clients that it could be that when we narrow this all down, the difference between your blue sky and your black sky is $15,000 and the cost of trial is going to be $30,000. Just, you're better off to pay the other side the $15,000 and not pay us the $30,000. Some clients are going to say they'd rather pay us the $30,000. Principals are costly. But other times, it's just going to be a matter of wrapping it up and recognizing and working out maybe some small compromise with opposing counsel because they're looking at the same kind of price for their client as well. I don't feel that this has been the best in-depth discussion of cooperative law, but I think I've given you a good idea of how this process takes place and how it can be financially advantageous to you as opposed to the collaborative proceeding. I also can't really give you a lot of specifics because I don't want to compromise any cases or any clients that I have represented or am currently representing. So forgive me for the lack of complete specificity, and I hope that you find this helpful. Thank you, and have a good day.